Hey everybody, my name is Jesse Bloom and I am the chef for a company called Sacred Kitchen. And we believe that food is the universal language. It's the one language that all humans speak. It's more primary even than our political persuasions, so that if we're actually able to make food together, we can have conversations, we can have interactions with people who we may not have known before or may not have related to before. I'm here to show you this extraordinary Bosch electric induction cooktop. There's a lot of advantages to working with this one. As a chef, the thing that I love the most about it is how fast it is. It feels like it's about twice as fast as a traditional gas stove. It's also super easy. All you need is the pans with the right type of metal, and you have an induction system that is completely ready to go. Today, what we're gonna be doing is we're gonna be making some quinoa, and I love to toast my quinoa before I make it. We're gonna get this quinoa nice and roasty toasty. A few other things that are really lovely about induction cooktops: they are 10 to 20% more efficient than your average electric usage stove, and they are super easy to clean, and they're really, really safe because you're not dealing with live flames. The moment that you move the pan away, any heat stops, and you end up with a very, you know, easy to touch range very quickly. One of the cool things about it is even if I removed this, which is just heating, it's not very hot. I just want you to listen to something. Do you hear that? Do you hear that? No? Well, that's kind of the point. This range hood is extraordinarily quiet. How many of you at home, when you're cooking something and it gets a little bit steamy, you end up turning off the range hood because it's too loud and you can't have conversation or you can't even hear yourself think? This hood is super quiet. It has remote blowers and it has an equal intake and outtake of the exhaust, which is awesome if you have an airtight home where you're being really mindful of your energy consumption. If you are doing something that's high impact from a smoke standpoint, this hood will totally crank. And even then, you can almost not hear it at all. Awesome stuff. My culinary journey really started as a child around my grandmother Ruth's table. Ruth was a classic Jewish American grandma. There was always butter cookies when you walked into her house, and there was always room for one more at her dinner table. Well into her 90s, there were people gathering around her table, the young activists talking about the world and often bemoaning the state of the world while eating some of Ruth's delicious cooking. And that heart for community, that heart for people, is really what has always drawn me and inspired me to cook and to create a business and opportunities for people to connect around food. I was just talking with a great friend of mine and we were talking about quinoa, which is suddenly ubiquitous, but 20 years ago, the only people who knew about quinoa were hippies who had traveled to Bolivia before. Now, my parents met in Bolivia in the Peace Corps, and so I grew up with quinoa, and I always thought that it was great, and it was something that they added simply to our soups. We are gonna be doing some different stuff with it today. We're gonna be making a delicious quinoa pilaf to go with a meal that has some animal protein. It's got some salmon, but other than that, it's vegan. And that really speaks to the way that I try to have a lot of consciousness in the food that I make, the way that we, I think in our food choices, need to consider both what makes our body healthy, but also what is ecologically sustainable and responsible from a food perspective. So having primarily plant-forward food and plant-based food is a critical piece of making sure that what we're eating as humans is also working for the entire planet. So I want to show you one of my all-time favorite, like, super easy culinary hacks, culinary tricks, and that is peeling ginger with a spoon. In any commercial kitchen that you go into, you will find somebody peeling ginger with a spoon. And this ginger reminds me of, again, of my grandmother and the way that her food was this interesting blend, this utterly American blend of Eastern European, Jewish, Ashkenaz food, the food of our ancestors, and her personal favorite, Chinese food. So grandma made a mean sesame chicken. And I think that's one of the things that's really, really special and really striking about American cuisine is the way that it has created a home and a beautiful fusion for cuisines from all over the world. And I think that when I think about food, I'm always thinking about how does this relate to people? And I think one of the most impacting things to consider in our food system is just how dependent it is on human migration. Humans have been migrating for forever, for millennia, and our food system is actually utterly dependent on immigrants, both in ancient terms from, you know, the way that the tomatoes made it over to Italy and then became a staple of Italian cuisine, even though they're North American food, to the way that we would not be able to eat today, even remotely close to as well as we do, or as economically low a price as we do without the immigrant labor that fills our kitchens and our fields. So thinking about food and the intersection of food and justice is super critical. There's no organization I know of that does a better, more impacting work on that on a global level than Slow Food. Slow Food is a movement that started by Carlos Petrini in Italy as a response to McDonald's coming into Italy, I think in the late 80s or the early 90s. And Slow Food is really about the best of how food brings us together. It's about taking a moment, pausing, and enjoying that ancient ritual of connecting with other humans while making something delicious. This is not an app for getting your food in 5 minutes. This is not about being a professional chef and having skills to be on the next Food Network's next amazing home cook. This is about sitting down with people that you care about, slowing down, sourcing your food mindfully, knowing your producers, and making delicious and amazing food. The simple rule I have in my kitchen is if it tastes good to you, it probably tastes good to the people that you're feeding. It's not complicated, y'all. I think the world would be a different and more balanced place if we all cooked a little bit more and enjoyed meals in a slow food way with one another. The thing I love the most about food is how it brings people together. Food is the universal language. It's the one language that we all speak. And no matter where you're from, you can appreciate the beauty and the magic of great food. So I love getting people together to cook. And we call it Sacred Kitchen because in its simplest form, what's sacred is something that connects us to something that's bigger than ourselves.